So hi, I'm Nicolas, and I'm a game designer. So from what I heard in this great conference, I must be quite hard to manage, and maybe a weirdo yesterday, that's what I heard. So my weird idea today is that we can use UX mindsets to accelerate game conception. So that's what I will share with you today. I will go quite fast because I have a lot of topics, but and I want to open for questions. And why exactly do I want to share about that? And I selected five tools or mindset that we can use always in game conception that are inspired by UX design or UX mindsets. And one way I try to manage conception teams being user-centric. And why do I do that? It's because it's often the case when I look at game productions that if you fast forward 3 years in development, you arrive to that in the playtest 3 years later. So basically you spend 3 years of money and to arrive to that, you always seen that. And the worst part is that, even if they understand, they cannot execute. And what did we measure? It's something that I call a disconnect between the intention and what the reception was, the perception was. It was more about an unadapted UX than a bad UX often. It's more like a misalignment between the beginning and the end. And I think it's caused because of that. It's the team is not working on the original idea with the right player. So in the end, everything is misaligned and we have those results. And the thing is that it costs more money to adjust that later and it reduces the potential for creativity, which is my job, to be more creative as soon as possible. And I think that some UX design mindset or skills for all the team might help on those problems. So that's what I will be talking about today. I've been working in video games since last century. I am a programmer, I still program. I have been doing a lot of creative design, technical design and creative direction at Ubisoft, and I spent 5 years trying to understand how I could be a better creative director, because I was quite bad, so I tried to improve myself. So I spent 5 years doing that and sharing tools about that. And so I like to think that I'm thinking like that, like how to be a user-informed creative director. And my crazy vision for today is that user-informed designers are better designers, believe it or not, and because they will be less stressed, and in the end, they can be more creative, because that's my goal. And UX design is a sport that is better played in team. We've seen a lot of talks about that, how to drive the team, organize your team. And it's like a soccer team. The players alone, like Ronaldo won't win the World Cup, the French team won because they were a better team, not better players. That's the year to use it. Huh? Okay, because I'm French, sorry. So I'm a game designer, I'm French, sorry. Often when I meet teams, they don't know where to start because there is so much stuff in UX design or game design that they don't know exactly where to start. And because it's a very large, quite well-known concept or not. And also it's used way too late. So often it will cost a lot of money later. That's why I want to share practical mindsets that everybody can use, even myself, because those are my notes for myself when I design new stuff so that I'm less stupid. And one process that I know use to drive a conception in a more rational way. And so that's what I share to teams, to the small ones and particularly even big ones for conception phases. So I'm focusing on that super early phase. So it's a very vaguely well-known concept because as someone said earlier, the definition is that it's all aspects of interaction with the product. So basically we are all working on UX in the end. Everybody on the team is working, so all trends are working on UX. So the cool part is that probably we'll make more money because UX is the hot topic of the... The thing I think is that it's more that we all need some at least understanding of what is a UX mindsets and how they can be useful, whatever our trend. Even if I'm planting trees in a game, they can change the path and that affects the UX, the user experience. So I'm using UX as nearly a player experience, as someone told this morning. I like that term also, player experience. And UX design, it's a lot of topics also to understand. So, and signs and feedbacks, you know, it's made of layers in a game. I'm talking about that because in the end, why that misalignment happens is that we have these multiple layers of things that are in the game that are in between the players and the systems. If you multiply that by the fact that we have many different players, and particularly in the game as services, the topic is already quite complicated. And if you multiply complicated by the fact that everybody is working on UX, the topic becomes quite complex. And I think that's why it's very hard to work rationally on those topics, that it's a complex topic, and complex topics need special ways of operating. Complicated topics need specialists. Complex topics need people that invent new processes. Complexity looks like that. I think that's the best drawing for the game development from start to beginning. And we think we are on the right, but in fact, we are on the left at the beginning. Okay, anyway, so today what I want to share is five things that I think are useful to navigate that drawing. And we need to start somewhere with the design. We start with an idea, so we need to embrace that idea. Then becoming player-centric is useful to gather ideas from externally and feed the idea that we had. Then we need to use accessibility, usability, etc., to make that usable, obviously. Then working on form often becomes something like a nightmare, so I'm trying to figure out how to make that clearer. And in the end, how do we measure progress? How do we know that we are going into the direction we want? That's what I call player-informed. I don't like that much the centric approach, because centric approach has the negative connotation of being designed for someone. And designing new games, it's only a part of the solution. So the design, you know, it's about the famous mental model in the definitions of UX. And in games, the model is the thing that the players view, and they control it, and it changes the model, and they build the mental model of the game. But the thing is that it's not as simple as that. The mental model, there is this formation thing. There is the model that you define on the design. Like, for example, in MMO, there is a combat with monsters, with players, with the aggro area, plus big monsters that are maybe external to the aggro area. But the players, they build a mental model from what they see. And from what they see there, maybe they will think we need to work together, because we're only three players, there are five monsters plus a big dragon, so we should be careful. So we should watch out for aggro. But they build that model from the filters that they have. And players, they have basic filters they use right away. When you start a game, what do you want? You want to do? You want to not die. So you want to find ways to survive. And so that's why we need to work together. And we want to meet min-max. How can I get as much XP or as much gold as possible in that game as quickly as possible? So that's why we need to watch out for aggro, because we don't want to die also too often. But when a UX designer, whatever it is, or what it could be, a game designer, or a texture artist, or someone else, removes, for example, the aggro circle on the ground, suddenly the model changes to be super careful with aggro, because suddenly we don't know exactly how it works. So working on the presentation can change the perception of the players. That's why I prefer to think about that like a formation aspect. So it's UX designer choices plus player filters that build that model in the end. So obviously we need to start from the model, but we need to accept that it will change through the filters. And we need to measure that. So think information for that, for the model. So yes, it starts with a model. We need an idea that we want to test. And user researchers and testers know that we need something to test, an hypothesis at the beginning. So we need a why. We need to start with why. So that's the first thing. We need to state the model somewhere. Second way of thinking that is to start to be player-centric is to take an external point of view. And often that's where fights and discussion and intense discussions can happen. Why should we do that? Because I don't know about you, but when I'm in a design meeting, that's what I see all the time. Like, okay, I'm playing like this. In this other game, they do like that. So there is this starting to be a fight. And suddenly there is a third challenger that comes in the room. It's the infamous design by control designer. Okay, it's in the Destiny 4, when we press A, it will shoot the shotgun, and B will be reloaded. Okay, cool. But in the end, the discussions, and the last guy that arrives, or the last girl, I saw a movie yesterday. So people are laughing to death. The idea there is to take the point of view of the player to start to filter our model. And the trick there is to think of players. First thing, which is super simple, that it's often forgotten at the beginning, it's players. And there are tools to do that. UX tools, well-known tools like personas. Personas are cool, but they are mostly about buying behaviors or the real person you are in real life. So that's why I like to use what is called design personas. It's the optic of looking at what I'm doing in the game as a persona and thinking about needs and pains in the game. Personas are like, often when I see them, they're about income, age, so it's a lot of money, male, and it changes all the time, you know. The more the projects advance, the larger it is, the persona. And you get the idea. It's mostly about pricing and buying habits. It's super useful for marketing and positioning, don't get me wrong, but design-wise, it's quite complicated to map that to the design you're working on. And design personas, I won't dig too much into that, but it's about needs, pains, gains, and play behavior, and motivation. So motivation, there are a lot of theories about that. There is one I like very much is cell determination theory, but you can use whatever you like. So it's more about the value that the players get into the game. And it's a useful team for in-depth communication. That's something that I can use to talk to artists or to, programmers or producers, and it helps the in-depth team communication. One trick there is to design at least two design personas that are quite extreme, to challenge your design and challenge the team. So that when there is a discussion, you can use them to see through their optics or through their lens what your design looks like. So extreme way of playing, you think about that, because maybe you are there, maybe the artists are there, maybe the programmers are there, the testers are probably there. That's okay, in fact. So that's an exercise that you can do as a team, is design the two main design personas of the team that for now we use as references. And they can be used for usability. For example, imagine any game where there is a result screen and fighting, for example, for Honor, whatever, but you know, there are those result screens that you see in the end. And using the design persona, maybe you can say, okay, the generic play, generic action is A goes to next screen. But maybe for the competitive player, a long press shortcut on A to skip all the screen could be useful. But that's for her. And for the guy that does not get how it works, maybe a timer that goes to the next screen could be useful. Why? Because in the end, we want everybody to refight. So that's a way also to separate discussions and stop fights in discussions. Could be used also for inclusion. For example, imagine that some specific needs player could be design personas. If we use that and apply it to UI discussions, meetings, fights, there is the world famous invisible UI. You know, the next game will have an invisible UI. Because this time it is our game, so we'll do it without a UI. The UI will be invisible. If you look at a super successful game like Crusader of Kings, huge success as a game, the UI looks like that. So it's not quite invisible. But in fact, it's transparent. It's transparent to the model of the game. This game is about hierarchies, being married with kings and queens, etc., etc. So the UI that shows those hierarchies and families, that's the game, in fact. So the mindset there is to think transparent, not invisible. And it's your game, it's your players, so your sign and feedback interfaces should be transparent to your model for your players. It's fine to know all the games, but depending on the design we have and the customers we want to reach, let's pick what we need for our project. Then we need to stay usable. So you need to read Celia's book, for example. And I will take a case that I see all the time is the introducing the game systems. Once we know our model and we want to introduce them to the players, and epilepsy warning there. So that's a game I like very much. Huh? Those are the tutorials. It's a very good game, Amdin. There is even a tutorial for the tutorials. But the game was successful for many other reasons that are perfectly valid. Huh? So if you ask the tutorials police, I don't know Celia, but I think it's quite high as a speed. So it's 3 screens per minute. It leads to that. The issue is that the player can't see anymore. You know the short-term memory is quite quickly full. And then the problem is that they can't think anymore. And if they cannot think anymore, they cannot get the systems anymore, and they don't know what the game is about. After the tutorials, I already did them before, a week before, and I could not really clearly see what's the problem in that game. But what's the challenge in that game? So the way I share it to teams is to say that in the tutorials, we want to introduce the players to the problem or the tension in the game. You know, when you start a game, you want to know, okay, what do I need to do? And oh, it will be difficult to do, and what I need to achieve to make that, to succeed at that. So, because players, they want to play. They want to discover a new problem, and they want to, in the best game, discover new tools to play those problems. There is a game I like very much for the onboarding, is Super Mario Maker, which is an amazingly complex product in the end, because you can edit a lot of levels, but yet kids get it right away. My daughter, she built 30 levels in 2 days without me even touching the console. And if you look at the intro, I don't know if you saw that game, but when you start, it's Mario, the old version, right away you play, you jump, and suddenly there is a big hole that obviously you cannot jump because it's way too big. And that's where they introduce the fact that you can build stuff, and in 3 steps, right away, say, okay, in that thing, I will be able to build blocks that I know to solve those problems that I see them like holes, etc. So that's what the game is about. And then they introduce super complex tools, but as you already understood what's happening in the game and what is my goal in the game, what can I do, you will accept the tutorials of the tools way in a much easier way, in fact. So that's the way I want to see. They don't want to have problems to understand the problem, but you get the idea. The problem with speed limit is that it's something that is not constant through the game also. UI part 2. So that's the UI for World of Warcraft at the beginning. So it's perfectly transparent to the game systems. I have enough icons to do what I need to do. I have enough information compared to what I need to do to understand that game. But if you look at someone reading the game, it looks like that. And yet that interface is transparent for someone playing the game at that level. I mean, I don't understand anything, but people reading, they need that. So it's quite transparent, even if it's full of squares of different colors. Sorry. I think the mindset there is to think of UI transparency over time. At the beginning, it's I need that interface. At the end, I need that interface. So the UI design is a function of time. That's my point of view. It gets more complicated because yes, for one player, it may be that case, but for another player, it may be that they want to achieve that. They may be an explorer of the world, and maybe they want to go that way. So it's a function of time and design personas. That's why I think your design personas are useful, because it helps you sort your discussions in that matrix. So UI design is a function of time and design personas. And then designers, in fact, find in the design or the way we do the game, okay, I'm more like that player, so maybe I should be in charge of that, in fact. Maybe in a game, we could have like several game directors, one per design persona. Next one. Okay, next we arrive to, okay, but this is all fine, but it will take a long time before we start to do a UI work and UX work. You know, it's the fear that, okay, we are starting to work on the form. And it's cool because, ah, yes, we are doing form, it will be super cool, we'll draw things, etc. But soon enough, I don't know, in my experience, it starts to look a bit like Vietnam, you know? It gets super slow, and as someone said at last UX Summit, we won't fix it in UI. I think we won't fix Vietnam in UI, that's the same thing for game design. So I think there is one word that can help teams also on that side, is because often we see that, we see a form flow function. And the wording like that, I think it kickstarts a sequential way of doing things for teams, where it's more like running a factory, like, okay, you will do the design, I will do the form, and then we will do that. And suddenly we are not in an iteration mindset. So that's why I prefer that way of looking at it, where it's about fitting. How the form fits with the function. And suddenly it's not about a sequential mindset, but more about like an iterative mindset and a team mindset. We need to iterate to find what is the best form for that function. And we can start to do that together. Also, to iterate faster on that fit, a trick I use is to separate concerns. to me, there are three concerns, like the functionalities. And often I like to use that even without icons because everybody can read. And there is there are the iteration on that direction. Maybe we'll use icon, maybe we'll use, skeuomorphic stuff or immersive stuff, etc. But that's another topic, I think. And particularly in conception, in prototyping, I don't see the real use there. Or maybe prototype it on the side. And the style, I separate even style. Once we know it's a vampire game, that's okay to do that. But suddenly we started to have like a usability problem, so it's not what we want to have in prototyping. And so I think prototyping of function is somewhere where you can start to share and teach everybody to think in a UX way. And that's a spot where we can use the famous book. Everybody knows that book, right? I think we should add now and here. We can use that in prototypes. And I think that's a perfect area where we can actually do that because we are fast and that book is super easy to read and understand. So how? In functions, we want to expose the model of the game. Imagine we have a game where we want to access the inventory in the prototype, scare the player, and give a feedback for a coin which is picked. The idea is to aim for max usability, like he said in the book. So the warning is to be careful not to use AI debug text because those require a large effort, a large mental effort to understand the system with those and to avoid styling stuff right away. And the trick also is to use convention that everybody understands. Like for example, words with Roman characters, at least in the prototyping phase, everybody can understand that. And for example, the disk icon, I know I'm old, so I know the disk icon. But if I would build the game for kids, or even people who are like 18 or 20, I would prefer to have a button with written on it, save the game, because I'm sure that there won't be any friction to go there. And for sounds, I cheat also. For sounds, I don't record new sounds. I steal sounds from known games, so that I get nice feedbacks, and you don't have to learn new sounds, because same, it adds a friction. So what I do is I steal Super Mario sounds, for example. So for the coin pick, if I use the coin pick sound of Super Mario, everybody gets that I picked something that is probably a coin, which was the goal, in fact, to expose that. And so inventory would look like that. Maybe I will use the sound for the coin pick and scare the player. It's the time to use an animation, for example. Because another trick is to think in channels. What are the best channels of communication for signs and feedback for each functionality? And there we can still achieve fast iteration on that. Because after we are going to production, changing an animation costs a lot of money. So the mindset is more like that, I think, like to think the form fits with the function, and the style is more like the icing on the cake, if you want. So that's the fourth pillar that I use. The fifth one is like, how do we measure progress? How do we know that we are targeting our goal or measure progress with the goal? So we want to, we want to navigate that. And to measure progress in that, it's not super easy. So what we want to achieve is be creative and manage. That's often quite a problem in discussions. So it's the famous meetings where you have the producer and the creative director. To be creative, we need to be able to propose ideas without fear, to avoid all the biases we know, the sunken cost fallacy, et cetera, et cetera. And to do that, it must be cheap. And to manage, we need to measure. If we cannot measure, we cannot share, and if we cannot share, we don't know what we are doing. So we need some rigor there. That's why I like UX mindset, because there are a lot of tools to measure hypotheses, etc. And it's a super well-known process, in fact. It's about proposing an hypothesis, to think about what we want to test as an hypothesis. It needs to be cheap, so we need to build the famous MVP. But the trick for the MVP is that there is not one MVP. It's the MVP for the test. Because often in literature or in mindsets, we say, okay, this is the MVP of the game. No, it's the MVP for the feature. We need to measure, so we need to observe. That's where we need to have UX people in the loop to be serious about measuring. And we need rigor, like I said, so we need to learn from that. Because observing just for the sake of producing a pile of paper for management has not really great use, apart being satisfied with the pile of paper. It's important because it's between learn and the next hypothesis that you can be creative. It's when you observe and measure something that you can make a decision or a creative decision. That's where you innovate and be more creative. And basically, if you look at that, someone talked a bit about this morning. It's everything that is described in the Lean Startup way of thinking. So measuring progress about having MVPs, but several of them. I added the I there because the MVP must be interactive. If there are no interaction, it's hard to measure reactions of players. And it's about having a mindset where you start with hypotheses, build something, measure and learn, and repeat and repeat. So it's all fine, but often the teams are like, okay, those are all like techniques, but we want to be creative. We are designers in video games. And we want to win the World Cup of UX Design this year. So how to do that as a team? So the way I do it now, and I try to imagine a process to make that happen. So what we want to achieve is to iterate with the players. To do that, we need an hypothesis. And an hypothesis, I won't dig into that too much, but an hypothesis, it must have owners. We saw that this morning with the team, the owners or the PO, something like that. And an hypothesis to be measurable must be wild. If my hypothesis is to say, okay, the pink is not pink enough, it must be a bit pinker, you won't measure that much. Must be, okay, no, let's replace pink with green. So we need wild hypothesis with owners. To do that, we need, in fact, to generate questions before. Who should be the owners? And in fact, the owners could depend on the topic we are creating, depending on the system. And to be wild, there is one super simple trick is to think about three ideas. When we have something to do, what are the three ideas that we can generate from that? And pick the wildest one. So it's about imagining wild forms for the signs and feedback we want to test. But to reach a wild form, we need first to list the functions that we want to test. And there is a meeting that I call the WTPMU meeting. But it's a super simple meeting where we gather and we answer that simple question. From the system and the model that we have, what does the player need to understand? And it's a question that is like opening, like there was a great talk this morning about brainstorming and avoiding biases in brainstorm meetings. Same thing, same idea there. We are looking at our system, but from the point of view of the player, what do they need to understand? And then what do we propose for them to understand that? And then do we have three ideas there? If we are creative, we will find three ideas. So the idea is to do that in reverse, obviously. And to do that, we need a team. So what could be the team to win the World Cup of UX design? So in big companies, we have specialist designers, a lot of specialists in big companies. We have specialists of content creations, like texture, animation, sounds, levels, and et cetera, animation, et cetera. And now we have UX specialists. The idea there is to build the team for the model that we are testing. And I think that way we can make sure that we work specifically for the model. So the idea is to start with the designers. It's missing something, too bad. So the designers and the content creators, and to get them into that meeting where we ask what the player must understand, and to list, okay, we want the player to understand that. And as soon as possible, to bring UX specialists when we start to propose forms. Because that's where the discussions on channels, on overload, and differentiation can happen. And the idea is to build those wild hypotheses together as a team. We decide what we think the player must understand, and we build a team which might be different per model for that model to progress together and get into those loops together so that there is no ego fighting and stuff like that. And every specialist has something to say. And there is no director there. What I measure is that it reduces fighting because in that meeting where we take the point of view of the player, it's not about us, it's about the players for our system. And also when we iterate, it reduces fight. And we keep the creativity because there is an intention, the design. There we can be creative because we can propose wild hypotheses. And then co-creating with the player is also an area where we can be creative and find new ideas. A simple example is imagine we are working on a game and the player has three levels of hit points. And in some game design, you would see, okay, there will be a life bar. And so we need to discuss the shape of the life bar. But if we ask ourselves, okay, what the player must understand in our game? Maybe we'll come to that. I'm safe, I'm okay-ish, and I'm really in danger. That's what we want the player to understand. So what can every trained texture artist, level artist, sound designer could propose to support that? And maybe we'll arrive to that, like, okay, we'll use vignetting, and maybe we'll use the sound of the heart of the player, and let's try that. Okay, fine. And once we get to iteration, maybe, thanks to playtest and user research, we'll measure that, in fact, it works, but it's clearer when the vignette is smaller as an effect and the sound is bigger. Cool, we found the best version of the wildest hypothesis of what we had. And plus, there are no life bars. So we arrive to something original. Maybe it's not the best solution, but at least we try something original. Quickly recap, because there is 1 minute left, right? So those are the five things that I use myself to change even myself when I'm starting to think about a new game idea so that I don't procrastinate too much. It's about wild hypotheses. And I think that's where UX design and UX processes are super useful because they allow us to be less stressed and create wild hypotheses which bring more creativity. It's really about what the player needs to understand, yes, but what are the wild ideas that we have to fulfill that? And if you remember my crazy vision at the beginning, I think that UX design and UX processes are super useful because creativity is about questioning. And the more we can create questions, and thanks to those processes, we can do more iterations on questions, we are more creative. And as a team, we are even more creative because we can bring more ideas into the loops and yet be less stressed. So my hypothesis today that I managed to onboard you on onboarding the design team. Hopefully, I did not reach that. I don't know. So I would like to thank you, but maybe there is a sixth thing I can add, maybe or maybe not. Thank you. We have time for zero questions?
Time for zero, yeah. Ah, yeah. That's correct, yeah. We have time for zero questions. So.
Thanks, Veronica.
Yeah. Yeah, I know.
But I'm available to chat if you want, because it's only an eye overview of that, because obviously there are a lot of details with a lot of specialists. There are also things to do with Lean Startup and customer development and advanced user research and stuff like that. So, but this is the framework that I use myself and I try to use to manage creative teams.
Cool. Thank you so much, Nicholas.
Thanks.